radio station for our two-hour show, talking to you about the Word of God, giving you great contemporary music, some lively chat, and just some food for thought. You'll be encouraged to know how very much God loves you and how He has a plan for your life. Join us this coming Sunday at 3 o'clock on Living the Good Life.
Are you looking for a job? Join me, Gene Hodge, on the Employment Opportunity Hour, Thursdays from 7 to 8 p.m., where I will tell you and share with you, as well as answer all of your questions and help you find enjoyable employment instead of a job. This is the only talk show that talks about everyone who makes up our workforce. Join me on the Employment Opportunity Hour every Thursday from 7 to 8 p.m. on the Employment Opportunity Hour.
Remember those great songs from the 50s, 60s, and 70s? Well, then don't miss JT's Oldies But Goodies. Saturdays from 1 to 2 p.m., JT will be playing the greatest hits as well as the forgotten oldies. These records are sure to bring back memories, so tune in and reminisce with JT's Oldies But Goodies, playing songs from three great decades. Saturdays from 1 to 2 p.m., right here on Tampa Bay's Tan Talk Radio Network. This girl will leave me
with a broken. Tampa Bay's Tan Talk, entertaining and informative radio for the Sunshine State.
It's now time for Connecting Caregivers with author, speaker, caregiver advocate, and talk show host, Linda Burhans, the gal who cares for caregivers.
All the caregivers around the world today, it's time to lift you up. It's time to celebrate. Good morning and welcome to Connecting Caregivers with me, Linda Burhans, the gal who cares for the caregivers with love, laughter, and lessons learned. Because you know I got plenty of all that stuff.
You do?
Yes, I do. And with me, as always, is my best friend, my co-host, and my sidekick, not psychic, Lynn Thornley.
Happy anniversary.
Today's our anniversary, 4 years on the radio.
Oh, wow.
Did you buy me a present? My husband always bought me good presents.
Oh, we'll wait till after the show. Okay. I'll have a surprise for you.
Buy me a glass of wine.
But 4 years on the show, like, who knew? And, you know, I was looking at everything yesterday. We've had over 500 guests. And I feel so blessed that we have this vehicle to reach caregivers. And to get out there. Absolutely. And how much it's grown and the things that are going on.
I missed 8 months with COVID.
Yeah, but you're here today.
Back now.
So I'm very excited about
that. We have a new somebody, right?
Yes, and we have on the boards today, we have Vincent. Hey, Vincent, thanks for being here with us today.
Well, thank you very much. It's good to be here.
It's good to be here. Yes, it is. And we have Doug Warner is with us today. We're going to talk to you on the second half of the show. Welcome, welcome.
Thank you.
But we have new listeners. And we have Sylvia from Zephyr Hills, Florida, Lori from Dade City, and Cheryl from Clearwater.
Welcome, ladies.
Well, yes, like I always say, we have plenty of room around the Connecting Caregivers table all the time for new listeners. Whether you listen live on the show, or whether you listen on YouTube or Facebook or Apple, whatever it is, wherever they'll take us, we're very grateful.
They're lucky to have us.
We're very, very grateful. So I got a great tip this week somebody told me about. So they live in an area where it's colder. There's been a lot of snow everywhere. And they can see their neighbor's window. Their neighbor is older. This is what they call it, isolation communication. So what she did is she went over and she gave her neighbor three pieces of colored paper to put in her kitchen window. So if she puts the green piece of paper in the kitchen window, it says everything is okay. And if she puts the yellow piece of paper in the window, it means she needs help with an errand or whatever. And if she puts the red piece of paper, it means that there's an emergency. I need you to come over. How wonderful.
That's brilliant.
How simple. And we really need to look out for our neighbors. And many times we just don't know if they're okay. Or, you know, we just assume they're okay. So I think that's fabulous. So anybody that wants to do something like that, please do that. Just three little simple pieces of paper. It's all good. So this week I went for my weapons, what do you call
oh
it,
my class. Goodness.
So when Tom died, he left me a gun. So I'm thinking, oh, I should know something what to do with it, I guess. So it was interesting. I still feel very nervous about it, but we'll see. I don't know how far I'll go with it or whatever.
There's nothing wrong if you feel comfortable with it. I have heard that people who don't use them enough or practice, you're liable to have it taken away from you by the burglar and you're dead.
Well, that's why I said I got a ring doorbell. Because if the bad guy comes in my bedroom, it's over. I'm not getting nothing fast enough.
No.
If I know if he's coming in my front door, I'm upstairs. I could lock my bedroom door. I could call the police. I could even jump out the window. You know what mm-hmm. I'm saying? Mm-hmm.
But nothing wrong with having a gun if you're comfortable with it.
Well, I just figure if there's going to be one in my house, I should learn about it. I should know about it. And then we'll see where we go from there.
It's like any tool. If you don't know how to use a power saw, you're going to be afraid of it.
Yeah.
That's right.
Yeah.
My husband wanted me to get one, but I knew who'd get shot. When he was having an episode, I'd be gone.
Well, you were somebody else.
That would be me.
That's what it is. So do we have our caller here on the line? Not yet. Okay. She's probably calling back in. So she's going to be calling any minute. Her name is Donna Hartley. She's an international inspirational speaker for over 3 decades. She's a former Miss Hawaii and television actress.
That's she's what worked she's with, so beautiful.
Yeah, she's beautiful. She's worked with Robin Williams and Dick Van Dyke, and she's told her story on NBC, ABC, PBS, and the New York Times. So she's the author of Fire Up Your Life, Fire Up Your Intuition. I like that. Fire Up Your Healing, because I'm on fire. Yes, I'm on fire. And the Healing Meditation CD. Is she my sister or something?
I don't know.
And also, she has published 6 stories in Chocolate for the Woman's Soul and 2 Chicken Soup series. So she's a go-getter, that's for sure. All righty. Hi, Donna.
Hey, good morning. How are you?
Joyful and grateful. How are you?
I am wonderful. I live in Lake Tahoe, and we had some snow last night, so I'm loving it.
God bless you.
We're having rain, and I'm hating it.
Oh. Yeah, we get one day of rain here, and everybody's like, oh, it's the end of the world. Yeah. I mean, one day this week, it was a little cloudy, and I was like, I could never live in New York again. You know, I just couldn't. That one cloudy day just brought me down. It was like kind of wacky, but
snow can make you happy, though, when you see it coming down.
And it's just so beautiful. Mm-hmm. And it's very lovely. Years ago, I brought my 2 grandchildren to Maine because they had never seen snow. And we got there, and there was like so much snow. And they go outside, and I made the hot chocolate and the cookies, waved by the window really good, went out and had my picture taken once. And they stayed out till they were blue. So, Donna, we're so glad that you're here today, and we want to talk about managing heart valve disease, especially during the pandemic. So tell us a little bit more about yourself and why you want to talk about this today.
Well, I have a history of heart because my family, unfortunately, everyone is passed on from heart disease, from aunts, uncles, mother, father, grandparents, even my stepdad. And
wow.
So I became very health and heart aware, but at 16 they found my murmur. But I've had 3 heart procedures
in
my life. So the last one, of course, was during the pandemic, which you have to go, you can't believe it, you know, that you have to go through a heart procedure then.
Oh my God.
They have a new heart procedure out that I did not know about. I've had open heart before to replace my aortic valve, but this one's called TAVR, transcatheter aortic valve replacement, and it's unbelievable. I was only in the hospital 28 hours.
Wow. Oh my goodness.
That's incredible.
Oh my goodness.
So it's a new, it's a new procedure. So I have a pig valve in me. This new procedure, they go through the groin, they go all the way up to the heart. It's in a metal mesh kind of casing that was developed by the military, and then your pig valve is in there, and they set it right inside of the other pig valve. And then attach it.
Wow.
So you don't have the open heart. You know, it goes through the groin. Yes, you have to lay 6 hours flat afterwards, and they glue it shut.
Oh, my goodness.
I know. They gave me warm blankets for my back and popsicles for my throat because they put a camera down your throat. But unbelievable to get out of the hospital in 28
hours.
Yeah,
that's
it's unheard of.
What they can do today, it just amazes me.
And you're feeling well?
Oh, unbelievable. I was very blessed. But now, again, I am a very proactive patient. So once I met with my 2 surgeons and decided whether it's SAVR, which was open heart, or TAVR, and I qualified for the new one with test and I was healthy, I got mentally ready for the operation. I said perfect health, perfect surgery, perfect recovery, you know, and I threw anything out of my house that was processed or sugar and visualized the success. And I'm a meditator, so I meditated. So after I got out of the hospital, and you're going to love this story,
I love stories.
To walk. That's kind of all I could do was walk. So I put my cat in the cat stroller, walked around my neighborhood on the flats, and we walked 500 miles in 3 months.
Whoa. Oh, my goodness.
And you think you're doing
I'm trying to get 10,000 steps in a day. That's fabulous.
That's, yeah.
With the stroller. Did your cat have a good time?
Well, you know, I did it the first couple times because I didn't know if I'd be steady enough on my feet. And after I did it for a week, then if I went to the front door, the cat just meowed, and she's just a little one, like, you know, 5 pounds, and she hopped in the stroller, I zipped her in, and off we took around the neighborhood. So there you go.
Did you get to meet a whole bunch of people, too?
I did that way because, I mean, I stayed my distance because of the pandemic, but everybody was like, is that a cat in there? Is that a cat in that stroller? So it was the conversation piece.
Yeah, I found out with the pandemic, I met more of my neighbors. Because a lot of the neighbors were home. They weren't going to work. They were out walking more and stuff.
Yeah.
So it was very interesting. Very interesting. Yeah, so how can people tell us more about heart valve disease and what people can do about that and how they can manage that?
Well, about 5 million people every year get diagnosed with it. The type I have, 1.5 people have this aortic stenosis. So first of all, you have to go to a doctor and you have to get a baseline of testing. For valves, it's the echocardiogram. That's what shows the result. So they're going to have to get that. They have to communicate. I think people have to ask more questions, you know, of their doctor and what they can do and how they can stay healthy. Plus, I originally had my echo, you know, like get one about every year and a half, scheduled in March. The pandemic hit. It closed it down. But about the end of April, beginning of May, I said, I'm going to see if I can get back in. See, I'm always testing to make sure. And I got in the end of May. And when I saw those lab reports, I knew right away that I had to have surgery. So people have to get that baseline, get the echo, talk to their doctors, and then they have to do what they can to stay proactive. You know, exercise. I don't care if it's walking. I mean, I'm a snow skier. I kayak in summer. You know, I'm very active. But, you know, you have to have some kind of activity. And walking, that's why I say, nobody has excuses. You can at least walk. So, and symptoms are very different for men and women.
Okay.
Men can get fatigue, chest pain, shortness of breath. I never had any of those. I was tired. My first one that I had open heart, that's the only thing. I was fatigued. I'm a single mom. What do you want?
Yeah. Then, I mean, who's not tired today?
I'm tired of just hearing about it.
And then the second one, because of the pandemic, you're in the house and I have snow outside. I had cold hands and cold feet. That was circulation, but I didn't know that at the time. No, it wasn't. That's why they were cold. So I think people have to tune into their body. And if something is not, don't be so like, oh, I'm okay. Just go in and get that checkup because these diseases are preventable. As I said, everyone in my family died, so I stopped the pattern. By getting checkups and being proactive.
And it's so important because, you know, we deal with a lot of caregivers, and caregivers don't take care of themselves. They take care of other people. Mm-hmm. You know, they don't go to the doctor. They take their loved one to the doctor. They don't eat properly. They make sure their loved one is eating properly. And it's so important that all of us take care of ourselves because otherwise we can't take care of anybody.
You know, I was so thrilled with my caregivers in the hospital, the people, the nurses, everybody that took care of me, because none of my family could go in with me. I mean, I had to walk through those doors
alone,
walk out of those doors alone. So I, being a speaker and an author, I did like a Mary Poppins bag. I took a big satchel of my books and CDs and all that kind of stuff, and I just kept pulling it out, and all my nurses, all my lab people, all my everybody, they got to pick what they wanted. That was my way of giving back to the caregivers because they did for me what I couldn't do for myself.
Exactly.
And it's scary.
Exactly. Yeah. And we need to be so grateful for the caregivers and because they're not just caring for us. They have their own families they're caring for and everybody else that they're caring for. And then they choose to take care of us also.
Right.
And that's a really big thing.
I'm extremely grateful for the caregivers, the staff I had at the hospital, and then Medtronics, because Medtronics was the one that developed this research, this transcatheter aortic valve replacement, because it wasn't around a couple years ago. So I'm very thankful, you know, that they had developed it, so my time in the hospital was less. And the caregivers were so funny. They give you all the paperwork when you're checking out. And she said, I want you to read it. And I said, okay. And I read it. And then she came back and she tested me on what I read.
Oh, wow. Really? That's Ooh. Rare.
That's impressive.
You would have failed.
And there's a whole other issue.
I luckily passed. I got one wrong answer. But I thought that was brilliant of the caregivers to make sure, you know, that I really was reading it and going to follow through. You know?
Yeah, it's I've even seen a lot of things before COVID with seniors that would go to the doctors and they would just hand them a prescription. They would never even get it filled. They would just take it home and not get it filled.
That's a good question.
So then they, yeah, go ahead.
I have a question real quick. As far as this aortic stenosis that you had, how much of it is genetic? Did they know or do you know? I know obviously there's a genetic component that you already explained. Did anybody ever, and in the medical, your medical folks, did they ever talk about possible inflammation, stress, these kinds of things having an impact on that stenosis?
You know, this is what they said. At 16, when I first had it, you go in the hospital, nobody talks to you. They did like a procedure, but nobody talks to you. I didn't get any information.
Well, especially at 16.
At 16, yeah.
It's crazy.
So I didn't know it was hereditary till much later. So what had happened, was I born with it? You have three like leaflets that go around the heart, you know, at the aortic. And two of mine were kind of together. So I really only had two leaflets that closed and opened. And when you get older and wiser, okay, but older, they said it got harder and it couldn't open and close and keep up.
Okay.
And that's what caused it. So whether that was aging, whether that was stress on it, you know, they don't know. But I think they didn't discover it until I was 16. So the murmur didn't show up till then. And, you know, I had a tough childhood. I had malnutrition in the hospital at six. I had violence and alcoholism I lived through. So I had a lot of stress in my life, you know, and then I survived a DC-10 plane crash. I had stage 3 melanoma. So, you know, I did everything in my power to keep the stress down, but obviously I had a lot of it, you know?
Well, stress is the number one killer in America. I mean, stress leads to so many other things. And that's why it's so important that you have these meditations. That's why it's so important that you went out and walked.
Right. And I think more people, caregivers and everyone, needs to be a proactive patient for themselves.
Yes.
They have to do some healthy steps every day. And to that question, I don't know if I probably got it from my line that, you know, a Irish line of health, you know, but then I managed it. By that, I mean all the other people had passed on from heart attacks or whatever. So at least I stopped that pattern.
All right. I got to ask you. Tell me a little bit about the plane crash. I got to ask you.
Okay. I was going to ask, but you.
Yeah.
It was a DC-10. It was leaving LAX going to Hawaii. I was a struggling actress in Hollywood at the time. And I, you know, I really thought of ending my life. I was at an all-time low. And this is what I say in my seminars, is that what you think is what you attract. But then I had a glimmer of hope. After 7 years of struggling, I was going back to Hawaii to MC the Miss Hawaii pageant. And I'm a former Miss Hawaii. So this was a big break for me.
Yeah.
Well, on that flight, I said, let my life change. And it did in 3 seconds. We took off. 9:22 in the morning, and we exploded on takeoff because tires blew on the left-hand side. Now you have all that fuel, so that's what took the lives, was the fires and the fuel. I was the very last one to make it out of the rear section, of that aircraft before it went. So that was life-changing. That was life-changing, I ended up testifying at the National Transportation Board of Inquiry, representing the passengers, people that died. And that's the moment I became a speaker, because I fought for a purpose. I had no idea that was going to be my career.
Exactly.
Well,
God had a different plan for you.
He certainly did. He hit me over the head, and I said, I'm paying attention.
Yeah, that's how it happens sometimes. But that's fabulous. Where can people find you, and where can people find out more about the surgery?
Well, there is a fabulous website, first of all, and it is called heartvalvesurgery.com. That was heartvalvesurgery.com. And you can, oh, they have other people that have been through surgeries. They have doctors post things on there. It is great. And go to Active Living, and you'll find all about this procedure. They have diagrams there. It's fabulous. And my, if they want to find anything about me, it's under my name, Donna Hartley, HARTLEY.com. And that's my website.
And I'll put all this information on our show too. So Donna, what are you up to now?
Well, you know, it's pretty calm with the pandemic,
yeah.
Right? So I'm doing a lot of Zooming, a lot of training online. That's
yes.
What I do. I snow ski at least 2 days a week. I love that. I do believe I'll be back on the road traveling and speaking. You know, I did not put retirement on my bucket list. Okay. So, and now that I have this bonus time still being on the planet,
yeah.
I do want to help people, because the message I have is, when people said, how did I handle all the crisis that came in my life? And then, you know, going through TAVR for surgery during the pandemic, I said, I had a wise mentor that said, every time something happens, look at the lesson you have to learn
mm-hmm.
and the gift. So
yeah.
Once I settled down after realizing I'd had to have surgery, I realized I had to listen to the research and the science and the medicine. Because if I didn't have the surgery, I wouldn't be here within 2 years. That's
yeah.
why valve surgery is so important.
Yeah.
And the gift was, they found it in time.
Yep.
So that's how I look at some of the tough things I go through in my life.
Well, God bless you, my friend. Let's keep in touch. And I'm so glad you were on the show today.
Thank you. It was my honor. Keep up the good work. And please send love and light and all good energy out to all those caregivers out there, because they certainly deserve it.
I will. Thanks. Have a delicious day.
Okay. Thank you, too. Bye-bye.
And now it's time to hear from our wonderful partners, because you know the deal. If you don't hear from them, you don't hear from me. So don't go away. We'll be right back on Connecting Caregivers.
This is the TAN Talk Radio Network.
Are you looking for compassionate and dependable home care for you or a loved one? Assisting Hands Home Care, serving Pinellas and Pasco counties, can help.
The day came that taking care of my mother was no longer the best thing for me or for her. Between kids and a job, I couldn't give her the attention she needed and deserved, and I was overwhelmed. So I reached out to Assisting Hands Home Care. Now I can see what an important decision that was, and I feel confident that my mother has compassionate and dependable caregivers who help her to stay happy, healthy, and home. Today, I'm able to visit with my mother and enjoy our time together, which is exactly what we both needed.
Assisting Hands Home Care. Call today for your free in-home consultation. In Pinellas, call 727-748-4211 or visit assistinghands.com. When you can't do it all, give Assisting Hands a call. Arden Courts is an assisted living facility designed to care for those that are struggling with dementia or Alzheimer's, where families and residents can feel the freedom with a nurse on site 24/7. Arden Courts provides specialized memory care in a safe and nurturing environment. They recognize every individual's physical, mental, and social needs and provide a secure environment that fosters independence for as long as possible. Walking paths, visual cues, and home-like amenities invoke a sense of freedom and independence. At Arden Courts, their goal is to make your loved one as comfortable, independent, and healthy as possible. They offer 10 hours a day of activities and programming with a unique setting of a home-like environment and 4 theme houses. It warms my heart to see how happy the residents are. Please call or stop in to talk with a representative. Arden Courts of Seminole at 727-517-7800, Largo 727-559-8411, or Palm Harbor 727-771-1600. Give them a call.
Is the fear of falling keeping you from doing the things you love? Do you suffer from diabetic neuropathy or plantar fasciitis? VoxLife can help. Whether you're caring for someone you love or being cared for, VoxLife wearable neurotech helps your body reach its full potential. Proven to reduce symptoms of diabetic neuropathy and plantar fasciitis, VoxLife also reduces the risk of falling in adults over the age of 55 by 8 times. VoxLife is a safe, simple, drug-free solution that optimizes your neurology. The biggest breakthrough in wellness in 50 years. VoxLife offers a 30-day money-back guarantee. You can't afford not to try it. To learn more about VoxLife, go to www.voxlife.com/caregivers. That's www.voxlife.com/caregivers. They help my parents and they can help yours too.
I see trees of green, red roses too. I see them blue for me and you, and I think to myself, what a wonderful world.
Okay, caregivers, now it's time for the caregiver affirmation. Take a minute, take a deep breath, sit down, close your eyes if possible, and just listen to these words. I know on my journey there is help and hope. I affirm that I am a good caregiver, that I try my best each day, and I recognize that I deserve to have my own needs met just as much as those for whom I care. I promise I will not allow myself to be consumed by my caregiving role, and I will set aside time in my busy schedule just for me. I am mindful of the other caregivers in my life, and I will let them know that I appreciate their efforts. I am grateful for the people that walk beside me. I will take good care of my own health physically and spiritually, drink enough water, eat quality foods, allow for time to rest and to exercise, laugh often, if only at myself, and seek medical attention for my own health concerns. I am who I am, and I allow others to be who they are. Today I will add one item to my assisting angels list. Then if someone calls to say, let me know if there's something I can do, I will be ready to accept their offer and provide them with the opportunity to assist me. It is an honor to be of service of others, and I will not deny my friends and family this honor. Okay, think about it, caregivers.
Yeah, think about that. I got an email from a caregiver this morning. She's another one that says, I've been listening to the show forever, but I'm a slow learner. She said, and I finally decided to reach out for some help. I needed some help, just things in the house that my husband wasn't able to do anymore as he's aging and different things, and he has cancer. And she said, my neighbors rallied around me and helped me with a whole bunch of wonderful things. So people want to help you, and people want to do the right thing, but if they don't know, they can't. And if you keep saying no, 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 no all the time, then they feel like they're getting in your space, and then they stop asking you. And then you're at home crying at night that you have to do this all by yourself. So please think about that, caregivers. It's really, really important. So Doug, so glad that you're here today. Nope. So I'm not going to give you your bio. You tell people what you do and let's just chat.
Okay.
So you are?
I am.
A whole bunch of stuff.
I'm a bunch of stuff. Yeah. When I was a kid, my friends called me Mr. Everybody. That was my that was my nickname. And I guess I'm still living up to that. Currently, I'm a licensed massage therapist here in Florida. I am a yoga and meditation teacher. And I'm also a advanced certified Labyrinth facilitator.
Explain.
Yes, I'm sure. I'm hoping that most folks have some idea what a labyrinth is. And this is the most recent addition to my my CV. A labyrinth, if you can picture it, a lot of folks will picture a maze, but a right. Labyrinth is it's a motif. It's just, normally speaking, it's a circular motif that has a path that is circuitous, and it always ends up at the center. Now, the difference between a maze and a labyrinth is a maze is a puzzle.
Okay.
Where you have dead ends.
Right.
If everybody remembers the movie The Shining with, what's his name?
Jack Nicholson.
Jack Nicholson. At the end, remember, he's in this hedge thing, and he freezes to death because that was a maze. There were dead ends.
Right.
So the labyrinth, though, is a meditative tool that you can apply in a variety of ways. The most preferable that I like to use is a walk, as a walking meditation. Now, here in our county, in Pinellas County here, we have a number of outdoor labyrinths.
We do.
We do. And I'll talk about a couple of them. I have a portable one, which is 24 by 24 square feet canvas labyrinth that I use. I do workshops and conduct these walking meditations on the labyrinth. The point is you can't get lost. All you have to do is follow the path. So I use it as a meditative
tool. Isn't that with most things in life?
It's that. Well, it's a metaphor for your life journey, your spiritual journey, however you want to look at it. It's rich with metaphor, but I've added it to the meditation practice that I teach as another tool for folks. It's very powerful and very engaging. So that's what I'm doing now. I do all three things simultaneously.
All right. So what do caregivers need to know? Caregivers are stressed out. Like heck.
Yeah.
Well, stressed out even more with COVID.
Sure. So in my last 27 years, I've devoted myself to kind of being, I guess, a stress expert, if you will. Mm-hmm. I'm not saying I'm more educated than a doctor or what have you, but everything I do, from massage to yoga to meditation, it all is leveraged towards managing what I call constant stress. You know, we have normal stress, which keeps us alive, you know. So the brake lights go on in the car in front of you, you slam on the brakes. That keeps you alive. Constant stress, which in the medical world they might diagnose as chronic stress, I call it constant, is stress without resolution. Mm-hmm. And this is what takes its toll. That's why I was asking Donna, your previous guest, about that, because one of the things that they're finding now in medicine is that the buildup of plaque in the arteries, with the, in quotes, bad cholesterol, which is not bad. It's there to save your life, okay? The idea is that when you're under stress, it causes inflammation. And the inflammation manifests very often in these blood vessels, the arteries primarily. The body sends cholesterol to patch the lesions or the cracks that the inflammation causes. It's like you got a crack in the road, they send out the road crew, right?
Yeah. Mm-hmm.
And that's the same thing that's going on with your body.
Okay.
So over time, more stress, more inflammation, more cholesterol, more patches, and pretty soon
now
there's no room and you have an occlusion.
Oh.
So inflammation is the kind of become the known
problem for everything.
The problem with a lot. And there's what causes inflammation? Well, we know there's foods that will cause inflammation. We know that there's a variety of things. But one of the primary things, the thing I work on, is this constant stress, because the body chemistry changes and it causes inflammation. So now from a strictly medical standpoint, stress needs to be addressed. And there's a million people out there, a million ways to, people are telling you how to deal with stress. But for caregivers, and I've been a caregiver off and on in my life, and most of the work I do now, a lot of the work I do now, is with caregivers.
Because there's a caregiver on every corner.
There is. So folks that come to me, I teach yoga classes virtually and live. I'm going to probably say a third of every one of my classes is full of folks who I didn't know at first. I'm not advertising necessarily. Okay, caregivers come. Right. But they're there for stress management. And I teach meditation classes and these types of things. And even all of it. One of the labyrinths that I talked about is one of the nicest ones that I ran into is behind the Woodside Hospice facility here.
Really?
In Pinellas Park.
My mother was.
Yeah. And that's where my stepmother passed away. We had her there, and I didn't even know it was there. And it's a beautiful labyrinth. It's 24 by 24 feet, and it's painted on a slab, and it's there. It's an adjunct to their chapel, and it's a self-guided thing.
I probably saw it, had no clue.
Yeah, and so it works. It's an amazing tool for that. I just got done doing, we were talking before we went on the air, a three-day retreat, a virtual retreat with a church in North Carolina, where we used the labyrinth, and it was all about building resilience and spiritual resilience, which is one of the things that
caregivers need.
Caregivers are needing.
And I don't know how you do it through the journey without faith. I don't know how you can manage without it.
No, resilience is, if I'm going to, of all the things, if I kind of look back at what I've been doing, I say, man, working with stress and what have you, it's really helping people build resilience, because life happens.
Right.
And resilience is by definition, is the ability to adapt and respond positively and effectively.
I'm resilient.
Yeah, you absolutely. I think if we get, you know,
I mean, you have to be.
You have to be. And you have to, you know, and
either that or you just lay down.
Right. In order to get where I've got, I made it this far. Something's working, right? We made it this far. Something's working. But adapting and responding are kind of two different strategies. And one of the things in the adapting, you know, so I teach adapting strategies and responding strategies. And one of the adapting ones, you've Donna talked about it, your guest, and you've talked about it, you know, taking care of yourself. Just body, mind, body, spirit, take care of yourself. Eat right. I mean, your little break there where you talked about the caregiver, you know, the speech there it was right on the money. But self for the caregiver, and this is what I found is that, and you know this, I mean, and I found it myself. I had to catch myself at the door taking care of different people. Yeah. Is we lose sight of why we need to take care of ourselves. I've worked with medical professionals quite a bit, but they're the hardest folks.
Oh yeah,
they're the hardest people to work with. I went to dinner with a hospice physician, really really good guy, and we had some other few people there, and he was so stressed out he was about ready to quit, and he didn't I was talking to him, and I wasn't preaching at him. I wasn't trying to give him a technique, but I'm saying, you know, you got to find ways to take care of yourself. He said, no, you don't. He couldn't hear it. And I said, let me ask you a question. I said, if you were a carpenter, would you leave your tools out in the rain to get rusty? And he said, of course not.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Good analogy.
And so I said, so let me ask you another question. Of all the things that you have at your disposal as a physician to help people, what's your most powerful tool? What's the most effective tool? And he sat there and he was thinking and he was, and he didn't come up with an answer. And I said, it's you. It's you. You are the most effective tool that you have at your fingertips. I said, I don't care about your MRI or your inoculations or whatever you got, because of you and your assessment and your diagnosis and your prescription, and your ability to do that. I said, if you're not taking care of you, then you're leaving your people in the lurch.
Well, I say to my caregivers, this might sound a little harsh, but if you're not taking care of yourself, you're doing a detriment to the person caring for. And they look at me like, oh, Linda. And I'm like,
it's irresponsible. And you could say irresponsible, and that's going to really kind of
inflame. We take better care of our cars.
Yep.
Oh, the fact that you said that is that I have said for years, I said most guys know more about how their car works than how their own body works.
Right.
And we do take better care of our cars. Think about when you go on we've talked about air flights, and Donna was talking about having that airplane crash. I said, when you go on an airplane and they give the little speech, this is a cliche, a metaphor here, and you've all probably heard it. And they tell you if the cabin loses pressure, oxygen comes down. Who do you put the mask on first?
Yourself.
Yourself. Because if you don't put it on you, you can't help the person next to you. But we lose sight of it as caregivers. And so that's my first message, is taking care of
yourself. Because I've seen caregivers pass away before the person they're taking care of.
Absolutely.
And then what happens? The worst scenario comes true.
It does. I've seen it too. I was a hospice volunteer, did 11th hour transition for about 6 years. And so many stories there. People who, like you were talking about, caregivers, a spouse being a caregiver for the other, and the caregiver goes before the person who actually had the disease.
Yeah,
goes.
There's a big percentage, isn't there?
Yeah, it's something like 67% of the people of the age of 68 or something.
Yeah,
full time caregivers die before the person they're taking care.
I was lucky because I was young when my husband was sick.
Yeah,
but I nearly killed myself anyway.
Yeah, I mean, you lost 50 pounds.
Yeah.
Wow.
Yeah, she was a mess. She was a total mess.
And it aged me. I used to look like a kid.
Well, I'm really 25. I didn't tell you guys that.
I'm really 92.
I'm 92.
This is the Mutual Admiration Society right here.
So, all right, simple ways. A caregiver is listening to this right now.
Right.
And they're very stressed. And I understand why they're stressed. I understand they're stressed because of COVID. I understand many times because you're dealing with an incurable disease, mm-hmm. Isolation, you know, the whole deal. But you realize there's something you got to do today. Where do we start?
Good question. So three or two basic areas that I offer, and I'm going to give you some techniques here in a second, something really simple to take away. The most logical, the most accessible is meditation in its various forms. All right? And because it's free. Basically, some basic techniques that can save your life are free. Yeah. Right? I could say everybody should go out and get a massage. I know the reality of that. Massages are not free, unless you get a gift certificate.
Some people don't like them.
And some people don't like them. But I will say that one of the things with massage, I'm just going to say a very brief thing about massage, is that human touch is a nutrient.
Yep.
It's not a luxury.
Yeah.
And not only, and when I worked with hospice, I was also as a massage therapist, and I worked both with patients and with family members. And the point is that we need human touch. Now, when you're caregiving, one of the things that I've seen in a lot of folks, especially if it's a spouse caregiving for, spouses, right, a caregiving thing, the caregiver often has lost or minimized the healthy touch that they used to get.
Yeah.
It happens.
Yeah.
And that whole thing becomes changed. And there was interesting thing about it, touch as a nutrient. There was a study done, and something I learned a long time ago, is in Boston during the, I think it was Boston, during the Depression, one of the largest orphanages in Boston, they were getting this huge influx of orphans, of babies coming in, right? And it was a great orphanage. They had a mortality rate that was, very acceptable at the time. With the influx of babies coming in, the mortality rate just skyrocketed.
Because they couldn't hold them all.
Because it wasn't food. It wasn't right. Stuff. It was because they didn't have enough staff to hold the babies. And the babies were failing to thrive.
Right.
So cradle to grave, touch is a nutrient, and it's a healing nutrient. And that's what I'm going to say about that. It's not a luxury.
No.
It's as important as, water and food and drink, all these other things. So as a caregiver, if you have an opportunity to, enjoy a get massage or other ways for healthy human contact.
Yeah.
This is important. Meditation, and I'll give another short blurb. Yoga is not for everybody. I think it's for more people than a lot of people judge it out. I teach a lot of classes virtually, which is really kind of a good thing, by the way, because if you can't leave the home, because you can't fit it in your schedule to get in the car and go to a yoga studio.
Right. And have someone care for you.
And then you got the whole logistical issue. So we have very gentle, restorative yoga classes that are online. And if it's not me teaching it, there's a lot of people doing it.
Yeah.
I'm not trying to sell just me. It's the idea. Yeah. You can turn that on your Zoom session and get a little bit of that exercise, a little stretching. And it doesn't have to be crazy. It's part of that. The other thing is the meditation. And meditation, we were talking a little bit about spiritual.
Mm-hmm.
And I'm going to put it into a context there. A lot of folks have a misconception about meditation. And basically, meditation is twofold. And the way I teach it is, number one, you're learning techniques to just kind of calm the mind down. You can't empty your mind. That's not possible.
Right.
It's not humanly possible to empty your mind. But you can navigate the thoughts and images that come through. And simply reclaiming your breath. Your breath is going to be, the breath is the number one most potent and readily available stress management tool you have access to.
All day long.
24/7. Yep. You don't have to download it. You don't have to go to Walgreens to get
it. Stop and breathe.
And breathing the way we were born. The diaphragmatic breath.
Really breathing. Yeah.
And it reduces the stress level. It does a number of things. The other thing I teach is, one thing I'd like to share is, it's a check-in meditation. It's a check-in. We need to stop, drop, and roll. And I teach a check-in process. And I call it's an acronym. It's called the PATH, P-A-T-H. It's pause, assess, take action, heal.
Go ahead.
Okay. And if we're going to
finish what you're saying, then we're going to take a break.
Good. So We're going to talk about, after the break, we're going to talk about the check-in and how to do, I'm going to take you through a really brief check-in contemplation.
All right, great. Don't go away. We're going to hear from our wonderful partners. See you in a bit.
This is the Tan Talk Radio Network.
Choosing the right chiropractor is an important choice to make. Located in Seminole, the Alexander Spine Center team is trained on the latest chiropractic treatments and technologies. At Alexander Spine Center, you'll find chiropractic and physical therapy care that is safe, effective, and a natural approach to pain and other health-related issues. Chiropractic unlocks your body's potential and natural healing process to ensure your life is a healthy life. We treat clients from the womb to the tomb. Call 727-397-3000 for a free consultation today or visit our website at www.alexanderspinecenter.com.
They take good care of me twice a week. And did you know they got the Reader's Choice Award for 2019 for the best chiropractic in Pinellas County? So check them out.
Arden Courts is an assisted living facility designed to care for those that are struggling with dementia or Alzheimer's, where families and residents can feel the freedom with a nurse on site 24/7. Arden Courts provides specialized memory care in a safe and nurturing environment. They recognize every individual's physical, mental, and social needs and provide a secure environment that fosters independence for as long as possible. Walking paths, visual cues, and home-like amenities invoke a sense of freedom and independence. At Arden Courts, their goal is to make your loved one as comfortable, independent, and healthy as possible. They offer 10 hours a day of activities and programming with a unique setting of a home-like environment and four theme houses. It warms my heart to see how happy the residents are. Please call or stop in to talk with a representative. Arden Courts of Seminole at 727-517-7800, Largo 727-559-8411, or Palm Harbor 727-771-1600. Give them a call.
Guaranteed to make you laugh through your tears, Linda Burhan's book, Good Night and God Bless, is filled with humor and heartfelt inspiration to aid anyone facing the challenge of caring for a loved one at the end of life. Her story offers hope for human strength and understanding of weaknesses during a difficult time. Life doesn't normally prepare us to become a loved one's caregiver. When it happens, it's usually sudden. A diagnosis of an illness, age-related frailty, dementia, and life suddenly is anything but normal. And because we don't even know what we don't know, where do we turn to for help or guidance? In Connecting Caregivers, answers to the questions you didn't know you needed to ask, Linda offers information, education, and inspiration from her own experience and from experts whose advice, practical tools, and personal stories will empower and guide you. Make sure to add these inspiring books to your collection today, available on Amazon.com.
Don't turn it off now. You need this stuff. Tampa Bay's Tan Talk Radio Network.
And we're off. Nope. That means that you need to get your pen and paper because Lynn's got good stuff to tell you.
I do.
Yeah, you do.
Okay. This Monday, March
8th. Yeah.
Gratitude and journaling reduce caregiver stress with Linda. And, of course, again, just go to her...
LindaBurhans.com.
Right. And it's at 11 a.m. And it's going to actually be the second Monday of each month.
Yes.
And you don't have to go to all of them, but it's a great help.
Come, and you don't have to be a caregiver either. Just come.
Exactly. And then A Daughter's Journey with Love, Laughter, and Lessons Learned is Wednesday, May 5th with Linda at 11 a.m.
At Freedom Square. So that
are you going to be at Freedom Square?
Right now we're live.
Oh,
so we'll
wonderful.
See how it goes. That's the first live, so we'll see what happens.
I will put that down.
Also, go to the website, go under events. You'll find my support groups that are online. You'll find Debbie Self Savages are there. So there's a lot of opportunities for support groups. And I'm in the beginning stages. We're going to be doing a three-day virtual conference in November 2nd, 3rd, and 4th for caregivers. So stay tuned. We'll tell you all about that.
I have to be up at 9, be out at 9 o'clock this Friday. She's taking me with her to go
to talk
to
about
talk.
It.
Oh. And I am not up 9 o'clock in the morning. I have hard enough time getting here noon.
All right, Doug, let's finish up on what we want to tell the caregivers.
Sure. I want to give you just I'm going to walk you through a very brief, I call it a check-in, stop, drop, and roll. I recommend you do this periodically throughout the day at least one time.
Okay.
And it's simply to check in with where you are right now, because I think most of you have probably had this experience in life where something tripped your, you know, irritated you, got you angry, whatever it was, early in the day, you didn't resolve it. You didn't pay attention.
You were busy all day.
You put it under, you were busy. At the end of the day, that little spark, that little ember became a forest fire by the end of the day. And it had predicated and colored everything else you did and thought. I think we've all had that experience.
Absolutely.
So the check-in is this. If you guys want to just maybe close your eyes.
Okay.
Let's do that. And what we're going to do is we're just simply going to, we're pausing. We're just going to step away from what we're doing. I know we're on the air here, but we're just stepping out of what we were doing. We're stopping. We're detaching a little bit. We're drawing our awareness inward. And we're drawing that awareness, trying to bring our attention to the present moment. And to help you do that, simply just bring your attention to the flow of your breath. Just notice your breath. Breath is always in the moment. Just notice the flow of the breath.
Not good for radio.
Yeah, let's see. Well, it's okay.
They're hearing it.
So just notice your breath. Now, I want you to simply bring your focus now to your body, starting with the soles of your feet, and just walk your feeling awareness up the body, noticing areas of tightness, resistance, lopsidedness. What's getting your attention in the body? What I call it your loudest noise. What's talking to you the loudest in your body right now? If you're in pain or discomfort, that's clearly going to be your loudest noise. And shift your awareness now to the mind, specifically your thoughts and emotions. Is there a thought, is there an emotion right now that's throwing you off balance? Whether you know the origin of it or not, what's your loudest noise in the mind right now? And perhaps, what is really throwing you off the most might be in a cat, and you might identify it in another category, your life situation. What in your life situation is throwing you off, disturbing your contentment right now? It could be relationships, finances, health, whatever. Okay. What's your loudest noise in the life situation? Of all the things you've identified, the body, mind, life, what's getting your attention the most? What's throwing you off the most? And this is what I want you to jot down. This is what you're going to, this is how we're going to use our journaling here. Jot down what your loudest noise is right now. Sometimes it might surprise you. And this is where we want, what we want to go after first, because then we can, whatever is irritating us, is causing us that stress of the moment, may not be what your intellect had thought it was
exactly
is going to be. Okay, so there are tools that we can apply. We can talk about another time, but there are tools. Okay, so but the act of journaling, observation is taking action. The act of observation is taking action. The other last thing, just to throw out, is in the stress management or arena, is and especially with COVID going on, and especially with caregivers who very often are homebound.
Right.
With, you know, with folks as identifying and looking at sacred space, finding a refuge in your environment.
Yeah.
A place, and it may be a place that's used for something else all throughout the day,
right,
except for the time you designate. That little corner over there in the living room with that chair,
right,
is my sacred space.
Yeah.
And I'm going to,
and it might be in the garage.
And might be the place that you sit down and do that check-in.
Yeah. Good idea. Good idea. Thank you so much for being. Where can our people find you? And where can they find? Tell them quick about your YouTube videos.
YouTube videos is, of course, it's youtube.com/Douglas Warner. No spaces, capital D, capital W. I've got about 50 videos there explaining a variety of meditation techniques, basic life guidance. I'm not a mental health professional. I teach from a meditation based guidance. And if you want open conversation, best way to go is go to my email, Douglas@warnerhealingguidance.com.
Thank you, my new friend. I'm glad
thank
here
you
today.
Thank you for having me. I appreciate it.
And thank you to all the caregivers for being here today. I know how precious your time is, and I really appreciate you being here. Tune in again next week for another fabulous show. Remember, God loves you all the time, and have a delicious day.
And nothing's going on. So
close your eyes and think of me. And soon I will be there to brighten up even your darkest night. You just call up my name, and you know.